Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Blackmouth by Ronald Malfi, narrated by Joe Hempel. There is no magic in recovery. Alcoholics Anonymous. 1. The Land of the Living. Chapter 1. Detox Boogie. 1. 1 week after our mother committed suicide, my brother Dennis was taken into police custody while walking along the shoulder of a winding mountain highway wearing nothing but a pair of saggy white briefs and what I can only assume to be an empty expression on his face. He had made it 6 miles out of town, which meant he'd been walking for hours beneath the blazing summer sun. When the police found him, he was dehydrated. His face was lobster red and glistening. His chest and shoulders blistered with sunburn, and the hairless bulge of his belly, which drooped over the frayed waistband of his underwear, was jeweled with sweat. He must have looked like some ripened tropical fruit, freshly washed. The only exception was his feet, which were bare and powdered in road dust. With each step he took, he stamped asterisks of blood onto the pavement. I learned all of this about Dennis walking along the highway in his underwear, as well as our mother's suicide, from a police detective out of Sutton's Key, West Virginia, who had somehow managed to track down my cell phone number and dropped me a line. Admittedly, the timing wasn't great. I was fresh out of rehab, a condition of my continued employment with the Ohio Foundry where I had worked for the past 6 years. I was operating a crane transporting a steel casting ladle of molten metal when the ladle adjustment failed. No one was injured, but the damage was considerable, as was the cost of cleanup and repairs. And that section of the foundry had to be shut down for a number of days. Lynn Pruder, my shift supervisor, pulled me into his office on the day it happened. He was a squat, potato-faced fellow with bad hair plugs. He stuck his face in mine, so close that the tip of his nose grazed my lips, causing me to draw back. "You're drunk, Jamie," Lynn said, nostrils flaring. His swollen red eyes ticked back and forth as he studied my face. "You goddamn son of a bitch, you stink like a brewery. You're lucky you didn't kill someone. Pack up your shit and get the hell out." So I packed up my shit and got the hell out. 2 days later, however, I received a phone call from the floor manager, an ex-Marine named Jaeger, who invited me to a meeting. I agreed, then immediately felt ambushed when I showed up. Jaeger, Lynn, and some well-groomed people in suits all sat on one side of the large wooden table in the foundry's break room, patiently awaiting my arrival. The people in suits were lawyers, I soon realized, once they started popping the brass clasps on their briefcases. When one of the suits asked me if I'd been drunk while operating the crane, inebriated was the word he used, I said I had probably been hungover since I'd spent quite a few hours at Donovan's pub the night before, but that I didn't think I'd still been drunk. When one of the suits asked if I frequently came to work hungover, I said no, not really, although maybe sometimes. Truth was, I was sitting there right in front of them with a belly full of lead and a hangover that felt like someone was using a tack hammer to the back of my eyeballs. Because hell, when you get fired from your job, you go out and get shit-faced, right? Anyway, I must have sounded reliable, or at least genuine, because the suits nodded at my response and seemed content. Jaeger, still sporting a military crew cut that made it look like someone had taken a push mower to the top of his head, actually grinned. Only Lynn Pruder, seated directly opposite me at that creaky wooden table in the foundry's break room, scowled. His face had gone the color of pomegranate, and his jowls quivered.
"This isn't the first time," Lynn spoke up.
He looked on the verge of having a stroke, and there was a vein as thick as a McDonald's drinking straw pulsing on the side of his head.
"This guy's a liability. He's gonna wind up killing himself or someone else. Sometimes he doesn't even come in for days at a time, and we gotta scramble the schedule to get someone else on the floor to cover."
Jaeger raised a hand, and Lynn Pruder went quiet. The lawyers at the end of the table looked nervous and uncomfortable. As it turned out, the steel casting ladle hadn't undergone a safety inspection in over 3 years. I guess a more industrious guy could have flipped the script and walked out of that meeting with a sizable cash settlement, but I was happy to leave my job reinstated. "One condition," Jaeger said, drumming a set of bolt-like fingers along the scuffed wooden surface of the table. "You gotta do a stint in rehab, Jamie." "I don't have the money for something like that," I said. "It's covered under your health insurance. Drinking and getting fucked up? It's considered a disease nowadays, like cancer." I watched the suits bristle collectively at this, but they did not interject. Anyway, it's company policy, Jaeger went on. No way around it if you want to stay on the floor.
You'll need to attend regular Alcoholics Anonymous meetings too, Mr. Warren, said one of the suits as he thumbed through a stapled packet of papers.
How often is regular? I asked.
Daily, at the very least. The guy had a pinched, bird-like face and an Adam's apple like a desk call bell. Company policy stipulates 90 meetings in 90 days.
That sounds like a lot. People really go every day?
More if they need to.
My insurance pay for that, too?
Those are free, Jaeger told me.
Been to a few myself.
I thought about it for maybe 3 seconds.
All right, I said, because I needed this job. Sounds fair.
Lynn Pruder looked like he wanted to launch himself across the tabletop and choke me out.
A few days later, I went into rehab. It was a 28-day program, the shortest one they offered, and the woman I spoke with over the phone assured me that I was very lucky.
There's usually a very long waiting list to get in, she said.
I didn't realize these places were so exclusive. Should I rent a tux?
The woman on the phone did not find me funny. I expected an institutional setting, one with stark white walls, crisp bed sheets, and caretakers wearing hospital scrubs. In reality, what I got was more like a VFW hall partitioned into various rooms, every wall paneled in imitation wood, and not a stitch of carpeting in the place. There were crucifixes and inspirational phrases and picture frames on nearly every wall, and a small janitorial closet that doubled as a chapel where you could pray to a plaster bust of the Virgin Mary or grab a push broom and sweep the floors, depending on your mood. Upon my arrival, I filled out some paperwork then and was taken to a room by a middle-aged woman with brash streaks of gray in her hair and blackheads nestled in the corners of her nose. A half dozen cots were lined up here in military fashion. The whole place was characterless, except for the acoustal ceiling tiles, which were decorated with the swirling yellows, oranges, and browns of water damage. The first couple of days were fine. I ate my meals, watched television or read books, played board games or ping-pong with my fellow inmates in a drab, wood-paneled recreation room that stank of cigarette smoke and the headier, semi-sweet fragrance of ass crack. There were 5 other men in the place, each one battling their own personal demons. Arms blackened with collapsed veins, mouths empty of teeth, body odor as acrid as volcanic spume. One fellow, thin as a rail spike, walked around with a perpetual smile on his face while his squinty little eyes dribbled a never-ending supply of tears. He would ghost from room to room like that, his expression never changing. I began to think of him as the Weeping Walker, although I never said this to his face. In fact, I steered clear of him altogether. So did everyone else. He was too creepy to engage with, so everyone just left him alone. The Weeping Walker didn't seem to mind. He just kept on weeping and walking. Nights were restless, but that was nothing new to me. I'd never been what you might call a good sleeper, although the nightmares that had haunted me in my youth had, over time, retreated somewhat to the shady corners of my subconscious. I would lie there at night, listening to the orchestration of snores and farts from the other guys in the room, unable to fall asleep. But it was nothing I couldn't handle, if it meant saving my job. But then something changed. I began to notice the mesh wiring over all the windows, and not just notice it, but to obsess over it. I was suddenly, mercilessly reminded of a place where I'd spent nearly a year of my youth, an empty place full of black circles, circles, circles. My skin grew itchy and felt too small. Claustrophobia tightened its muscular coils about my body. I imagined blood on the soles of my feet and drying in russet streaks along my pant legs. Those restless nights turned into marathons of insomnia while my head filled with non-specific terrors. I stared at the moonlit ceiling tiles, patterned with the shadows of wire mesh, with eyes that blazed like headlamps. Those swirling water stains conspired, in my mounting paranoia, to heckle and terrorize me as they began to slither across the ceiling. I became convinced that something had insinuated itself beneath my cot, slotted there like a peg in a hole where it lay in total darkness, lightly plucking at the grid of bed springs in the cot's metal frame. After several nights of this, I got rid of the frame and slept with my mattress on the floor. Some change was taking place inside me. I grew irritable, unsettled, twitchy. I found I couldn't keep my hands from shaking.
I felt both loose and tightly wound at the same time. I stopped eating. I screamed at the woman with the streaks of gray in her hair. Terrified of the dark, I slept only in the daytime, discarding even my mattress now and opting to sleep directly on the floor, which felt cool against my steaming flesh. The headache that was gradually boiling inside the crockpot of my skull was a constant, never-ending torture. I frequently sobbed with the heels of my hands pressed into my eye sockets for fear the expanding force of that headache might jettison my eyeballs from my skull. I vomited so regularly and with such intensity that my stomach felt like a balloon someone had pumped full of hot gas. Pissing myself became my favorite hobby. At some point, I was removed from the general population and relocated to a room no larger than a broom closet. An aging hippie with a long gray ponytail and an REO Speedwagon t-shirt tossed my duffel bag onto a fresh cot. I stared at the cot with renewed horror. Only when the hippie clapped his hands, a sound very much like the pop of a starting pistol in that suffocating little room, did I look away from the cot and over at him. The hippie leaned toward me, gazing straight into my eyes. Was this lunatic trying to hypnotize me or just peer deep into my soul? I recoiled from him, my stinking, sweat-dampened shirt sliding along the wall until I found myself trapped in a corner.
"Boy, you're riding the ride now," said the hippie.
His teeth were tombstones. That first night in my new room, what felt to me, in my unhinged state, like solitary confinement or maybe even a coffin, I heard a different sound coming from beneath my cot. Not the muted thwang of those plucking bedstrings, but the wet sound of an infant's mouth suckling at its mother's breast. This image of a child breastfeeding appeared at the center of my head with such inexorable force and unshakable clarity that it carved through the pulsing fog of my headache with all the authority of a lighthouse beacon. Gathering what strength I had left in my shaky, foul-smelling, unreliable body, I rolled off the cot and backed away to the far side of the room. Given the size of the room, this meant I was only about 6 feet from the cot. There was a single window in the room, a high and narrow rectangle of glass through which a channel of sodium light bisected the darkness and painted a distorted orange panel on the floor. A part of that orange panel bled beneath the cot, and I could discern, with a deepening sense of dread, that there was movement down there, a shape alive. I could still hear the noise, too. Until now, and despite the discomfort I had felt in this place as my body detoxed, it had never occurred to me to leave. I was here under my own volition. If I wanted to pack up and get the fuck out, there was no one who would stop me. Now, however, hearing that suckling sound and seeing that indistinct movement beneath the cot, the urge to flee was all-encompassing. Had I trusted myself to get as far as the front door without collapsing from a combination of exhaustion and terror, I might have done just that. But I didn't. Instead, I took a step toward the cot. I was hoping my approach would silence that suckling sound, the way crickets go quiet when you draw near. But that wet and greedy sucking did not stop, and with it arrived the vague whiff of smoke. I took another step, then another. A knot formed in my throat as my shins came to rest against the cot's metal frame. A figure wrapped in a swirling black cloak materialized in the darkness beside me. A voice in my ear, whispering straight through to the epicenter of my soul. "Do you want to see a magic trick?" "No," I said aloud. But I reached down and gripped the mattress with both hands anyway. No dramatic flourish, no sense of showmanship. I simply yanked the flimsy mattress off the frame and tossed it to the floor, where it raised a cloud of dust into the shoot of orange light spilling through the window. There was a woman lying on the floor beneath the lattice of bedsprings. An infant clutched to her breast. She cradled the child's pale, sloping head while it fed. The sound of its feeding rivaled the whoosh of blood funneling through my ears, my hammering heartbeat, the reedy hiss of air whistling up through the pinhole of my throat. Quick as a snake strike, the woman reached out and grasped me around one ankle with fingers that felt like bone. Stricken blind by terror, I was dragged down into the darkness. 2. My mother killed herself in the master bedroom of the farmhouse where Dennis and I grew up. She had drawn the bedroom curtains, switched on the bedside lamp that was electrically powered but fashioned to look like an antique flat-wick kerosene lantern, smoked a joint, and then ingested an entire bottle of prescription pain pills. Police found her supine on the bed, one eye closed, one leg dangling off the mattress so that her toes just barely grazed the dusty wooden floorboards. She'd already been dead for a week, and the summer heat had sped up her decomposition. The bedroom was dizzy with flies. As for what specific ailment those pain pills had been prescribed, it was up for speculation. On the infrequent occasions my mother and I came within orbit of each other, she would complain about her diabetes, her arthritis, persistent migraines, unmanageable acid reflux, temporomandibular joint dysfunction, irritable bowel syndrome, vertigo, chronic insomnia, double vision, and all variety of bodily aches and pains. She also had lung cancer, according to the autopsy report, although I assume she didn't know this because it had never come up during one of her pity-seeking diatribes. At the time of her death, I hadn't seen my mother or my brother Dennis in over 4 years, and I hadn't been back to that farmhouse since I was a teenager. There was a period when, on a whim, my mom had purchased an old Airstream caravan, one of those things that resembled a giant metal thermos on wheels. And she and Dennis would periodically travel around the country together like a couple of reprobates. At some point on their journey, they would detour to whatever neck of the woods I was holed up in at the time, and I'd spend the obligatory afternoon subjected to my mother's myriad complaints about her failing health, while she inhaled an entire pack of Pall Malls and sipped cheap vodka from a paper cup. Dennis would show me photos of their road trip on his iPad, the screen gummy with fingerprints, always sitting too close to me, the heat that radiated from his meaty forearm dampening my shirt sleeve. These visits usually took place in a park or RV recreation area, neutral ground. Some barbecue carryout container spread out on an old bed sheet in the grass, bottlenose flies dive bombing the potato salad and getting snared in the quagmire of gluey barbecue sauces. At the conclusion of each of these visits, Mom would give me one of her perfunctory little hugs, and then Dennis would gather me up in his big arms, squeezing my guts while yanking me clear off the ground. Yet like all of my mother's capricious endeavors, these cross-country road trips were short-lived. I think the Airstream was ultimately repossessed, too. The Sutton's Key police detective who informed me of my mother's death was named Aiello, and he spoke in that familiar, thick-throated drawl I had grown up to know as Appalachian English. He told me about Dennis shuffling half-naked along the shoulder of the highway, too, and how he had personally responded to the call because he was already in the area. Sure enough, there was Dennis, pink and shiny in the sun, doing the Frankenstein's monster shamble down the highway. Detective Aiello had gotten out of his car and approached Dennis, attempted to engage the peculiar fellow in conversation. But Dennis hadn't responded to the detective or even acknowledged that Aiello was standing there at all. Dennis had simply continued his laborious, barefooted trek along the gritty shoulder of the highway as if under a hypnotist's spell. Detective Aiello, whose law enforcement career spanned 11 years, although his transfer to the Sutton's Key Police Department had been fairly recent, had the good sense to realize there was something decidedly off about my brother, even without taking into considering the fact that he was trudging along the road half-naked in the middle of the day. So instead of attempting to slap a pair of silver bracelets on my brother and muscle him into a police car, which would have been a chore, Detective Aiello radioed dispatch for assistance, then proceeded to walk with Dennis for about a quarter of a mile. It was hot as hell, but Aiello figured he could use the exercise. Just as Aiello heard sirens coming over the hill, Dennis stopped walking. He blinked his small gray eyes, and for the first time since Aiello had joined him on his journey, winced from the sizzling glare of the midday sun. It was as though he had just been roused from a deep sleep. He turned to Aiello, some semblance of clarity filtering back into his small and somewhat childlike eyes. Some of the moisture on my brother's face, Aiello suddenly realized, was tears. Dennis said something, which Detective Aiello could not readily make sense of. He asked Dennis to repeat himself, and Dennis obliged.
"She is now dead," said Dennis.
The statement, delivered in my brother's odd and halting pattern of speech, made Detective Aiello uncomfortable. My brother looked like the dude from that Steinbeck novel who accidentally killed a puppy, and his whole lights are on but nobody's home affectation didn't help matters any. When police backup arrived on the scene, the officers wanted to wrangle my brother into the back seat of their cruiser, but Detective Aiello didn't think that would go over so well. Instead, Aiello got a blanket from the trunk of the cruiser, draped it over my brother's broad, sunburned shoulders, and agreed to walk all the way back to the farmhouse with him. Hours later, when Dennis and Detective Aiello finally arrived back at the farmhouse, my mother's body had already been discovered, and cops were taking photos of her desiccated corpse. "Where's my brother now?" I asked the detective. I was on my cell phone in my car, a 1972 puke green Ford Maverick with vinyl bench seats and a St. Christopher medallion superglued to the dash. It was early evening and I had the windows down, but the air was stagnant and the interior of the Mav felt like the inside of a kiln. I was in the parking lot of the First United Methodist Church on Mill Street in downtown Akron, where I'd been coming for the past week to attend AA meetings. I'd been back to work at the foundry for a week now, too, operating once again under the contemptuous scrutiny of Lynn Pruder.
"Well, you see, that's sort of been an issue," Detective Aiello said.
"What does that mean?" I asked.
"Well, Mr. Warren, it took us a couple of days to track you down, and we didn't have nobody else to call locally, so..."
"Where is he?"
"He's here, at the station."
I cleared my throat and said, "My brother has been staying at the police station?"
"He's fine, Mr. Warren. We had a medic come in, give him a once-over. He was dehydrated, and there were some abrasions on the bottoms of his feet from walking all that way barefoot. But he was otherwise okay. Thing is, we didn't know what to do with him, where to take him. We didn't think he should go back to the house on his own, given his... well,
no," I agreed.
"I was going to put a call into the state, see if they'd come and get him, but then I was able to track you down. Figured it'd be better to have you involved instead."
My head was swimming.
"Anyway, your brother is fine, Mr. Warren. He even seems to like it here. There's always someone around to keep him company. It's just that we didn't know what else to do."
"Is he there now? Can I talk to him?"
"Sure. Hold on a sec."
Then there was Dennis's breathy salutation in my ear on the other end of the line, the familiar halting speech pattern, the edge of urgency at the back of his throat.
"I saw her, Jamie," Dennis proclaimed. "She is now dead."
I closed my eyes. My body trembled like something hooked up to jumper cables. "What about you, buddy? Are you okay?"
"She is now dead."
"All right, buddy. All right." There was a jostling, then Detective Aiello was back on the line. Somewhere in the background, I could hear my brother's high-pitched keening, something like a laugh or a sob or some non-specific outburst of noise.
"If you do the quick and dirty math, given the coroner's estimated time of death for your mother, Mr. Warren, you'll see that your brother had been living in the house with her for about a week or so after she'd passed."
"A week?" My brother had been living in that house with our mother's corpse for a week? I opened my mouth to say something, but then shut it again. I didn't know what to make of this information. It was disturbing, even for Dennis.
"But again, Mr. Warren, he's fine. Your brother, like nothing ever happened. Everyone at the station has really taken a shine to him, too. Only..."
"Only what?"
"You'll have to come out here, Mr. Warren," Detective Aiello said. "You'll have to come and get him. As soon as you can."
"She is now dead. You'll have to come."
Blackmouth had finally caught up with me. 3. It wasn't that I had been spontaneously stricken blind by the sight of the woman nursing the baby beneath my cot, or the very real sensation of her bony fingers closing around my ankle. It was that I'd been overcome by what is known in the business as the detox boogie. In other words, I'd suffered a seizure as a result of acute alcohol withdrawal. When I came to, I was sprawled out on the floor of my tiny room, the undersea glow of early morning light leaking through the room's solitary window. The crotch of my pants was damp and the room reeked of ammonia. I was shaking, my body simultaneously hot and cold. When I rolled my head to one side, a dagger-like pain speared down my neck and detonated across my shoulders. The mattress was still on the floor where I'd tossed it the night before. There was nothing beneath the cot's frame but scuffed linoleum tiles and dust bunnies. Peripheral movement caused my head to turn, painfully. The weeping Walker stood in the doorway, his messy pink eyes leaking tributaries of saline, the edges of his sharp, cadaverous grin expanding beyond the confines of his face.
"Get somebody," I groaned.
My voice sounded like the squalling of a rusty hinge. The weeping Walker floated away. Moments later, the gray-streaked woman, her name was Dina, and the aging hippie, his name was Fred, filed into the room. Dina helped me sit up and gave me water from a plastic bottle, which I chugged until it was empty without coming up for air. Fred only folded his arms, leaned against the wall, and nodded his head. The look of satisfaction on his face struck me. It was as if he'd been somehow complicit in what had happened to me in the night, and the outcome brought him great pleasure.
"All part of the ride, my brother,"
he said, and pumped one fist in the air in solidarity.
"Welcome back to the land of the living."
That was how my 28 days in rehab turned into 60. I was there when my fellow inmates departed and a new collection of wild-eyed, trembling degenerates took their place. Only the weeping Walker remained, and since no one seemed to acknowledge him, I began to wonder if he actually existed or if he was something altogether fashioned from my own imagination. I had my cell phone with me the whole time I was in that place, but I never once made a phone call. Nor did I receive any, except for the periodic phone scams, where a robotic female voice who addressed me as Barbara urgently wished to discuss my student loan debt. There was no one in my life to call. No one sitting in a house or an apartment or in a car or on a bus or a plane who cared about what was happening to me. I had no real friends, just coworkers from the foundry who were good for a few beers after work, but I had managed to alienate many of them over the years. I'd wrecked too many cars, gotten into too many fist fights at the local watering holes, blacked out in too many back alleys. My absences from work caused them undue hardship, and they began to distance themselves from me after a while. There were the occasional women in my life, each one too transitory to be called a girlfriend. One woman, whose name I'll respectfully leave out of this sad dissertation, had been special. For a brief period, we'd even lived together. But I had done everything within my power to fuck up that relationship, too. 60 days turned into 90.
"It's like the aperture of the world's growing wider," Fred said one afternoon as we sat playing checkers in the rec room. "You start seeing all your past transgressions under that wider lens and it bugs you out, man. But don't let it get you down because, see, that's someone else's life. You're a new man now, amigo."
The idea that I was glimpsing past transgressions resonated with me. Most disconcerting was the inexplicable impression of finger marks in the flesh around my ankle where the woman beneath the cot had grabbed me. Everything else could be written off as a detox-induced hallucination. But this was the one thing I couldn't reconcile with myself. When I left that place, Dina gave me a hug and said she was proud of me. Fred presented me a handmade hemp bracelet and another fist pump in the air, which I returned this time. The weeping Walker, somehow still haunting the dimly lit rooms and wood-paneled corridors of that facility, peered out at me from behind one of the wire-mesh windows as I stood on the sidewalk, a grinning ghoul who may or may not actually exist. Some alcoholics describe storming into sobriety as a metamorphosis. Others have said it is closer to a molting, where they've shucked off their old skins and exist now, wet and radiant and alive, in new ones. For the first time in my life, I felt like I was filling empty spaces. 4. I promised Detective Aiello that I would head out for West Virginia first thing in the morning, a promise that felt like a lie even as I said it. Then I disconnected the call. Across the parking lot, a group of people stood outside the rectory doors of the First United Methodist Church, most of them smoking cigarettes. Emily Pearson was among them, checking something on her cell phone. I watched them until my wristwatch said it was 7 o'clock, and they began to file one by one into the rectory's basement for our nightly Alcoholics Anonymous meeting. 96 days sober, but as the saying goes, who's counting? 5 minutes later, I was speeding toward my apartment, a bottle of Kettle One wrapped in brown paper on the seat beside me.
"I saw her, Jamie,"
She is now dead.
At the time, I just assumed Dennis had been talking about our mother. I was wrong. Chapter 2. Mia Tomasina and the Sunshine Devil Girl. 1. Around the same time I was doing the detox boogie on the floor of the rehab facility in Akron, Ohio, an avant-garde filmmaker living in Los Angeles named Mia Tomasina had just sat through a showing of her most celebrated film, Dead Rabbit, and was stepping out into the back alley behind the theater to smoke a joint before the Q&A session began.
Hey. Hey there. Do you come here a lot?
Mia looked up from her cell phone, joint smoldering between her lips. A crumbling brick wall dressed in ivy ran the length of the alley. Mia didn't see the woman until she peeled away from the wall, her profile gliding into the sickly orange nimbus of a lamppost's light out on the sidewalk. She was swarthy and feline, something summoned into existence by a collaboration of shadows. Something, Mia instantly thought, not to be trusted. Mia plucked the joint from her mouth and said,
"Who's there?"
"Do you come here a lot?" the woman said again.
"What's your name?"
"My name is on that little chalkboard in the lobby," Mia said. The woman laughed. She scissored the air with two fingers.
"You mind if I grab a toke?"
"I'm not really in the habit of swapping spit with strangers," Mia said, which she'd be the first to admit wasn't altogether true. What she'd meant was she wasn't in the habit of swapping spit with strangers who looked like they were in the habit of prowling parking lots and back alleys for a fix.
"Aw, come on, sis, don't be like that."
"Fuck it," Mia thought, and extended what was left of the joint in the woman's direction. The woman crossed the alley, putting her bony hips to work and plucked the joint from between Mia's fingers. Her cut-off jeans were so short Mia glimpsed a bruised sliver of ass cheek when she pirouetted before her, hands arched above her head like a ballerina's. Mia couldn't tell if she had once been pretty or not.
"Yeah, sis, I think I seen you round here before. You must come here a lot."
Mia just smiled at the woman. She'd never been here before in her life.
"Don't you even want to know my name?"
the woman asked, still pirouetting. The glowing red tip of the joint rotated in the air as she twirled.
"Sure, why not?" Mia said. "What's your name?"
"Sunshine," said the woman.
"Sunshine Devil Girl."
"What is that, Polish?"
Sunshine Devil Girl laughed again, handed Mia back the smoldering stub of her joint. Mia immediately pitched it in a puddle on the pavement where it sizzled. Tss.
"I'm psychic, you know," Sunshine Devil Girl told her.
Mia had sunk to the concrete steps leading up to the theater's fire exit by this point, and Sunshine Devil Girl placed a ratty sneaker on the step between Mia's thighs.
"Does that bother you? Your foot near my crotch?"
"No, dummy, that I'm psychic."
"No, that doesn't bother me."
"It doesn't bother you that I could see your future?"
"It's not my future I'm worried about."
Sunshine Devil Girl drew her face closer to Mia's. Her eyes were too wide and her pupils looked to be two different sizes, as if she was suffering from a concussion or some other head injury. She wasn't very pretty at all, Mia decided. The girl's face was too sallow, her complexion ravaged by a lifetime of drug abuse and volatile boyfriends. There was a disconcerting sore at the corner of her mouth, which didn't help things.
"Everybody's worried about their future, sis," Sunshine Devil Girl told her, rather solemnly.
It was Mia's turn to laugh.
"Seriously, bro," Sunshine Devil Girl went on, ignoring her laughter. "I know what I'm talking about. I've got this gift. You can't bullshit me."
"Okay," she said, hoisting one shoulder in a half-hearted shrug. "But I'm no bro. I'm sis, remember?"
Sunshine Devil Girl would not be sidetracked.
"Let me tell you your future. If you're not afraid to hear the truth, it should be no big thing, chicken wing."
"No, thanks. I got no cash on me."
"I don't do it for money," she said. "I mean, if you had a pack of smokes, I'd take 'em, or another joint. I'm not a jerk. And I'd do other things for money. I mean, I'll eat pussy or whatever. But I never tell someone their future in exchange for payment. It's bad fucking karma."
"Yeah, hun, you look like the poster child for good karma," Mia said.
Sunshine Devil Girl frowned.
Or at least Mia thought she did. You don't gotta be a cunt about it, sis.
Whoa, okay, Mia said, holding up both hands in surrender.
Seriously, come on now, don't be a dick.
Fair enough, Mia said. If you don't do it for money, what do you do it for?
Posterity.
Mia's laugh was a bit more tempered this time. She started wondering where this woman had come from, how she'd just happened to materialize out of the darkness here in the back alley of this old theater. There was something on the front of her too small t-shirt, a graphic of a Ferris wheel with a grinning cartoon sun above it. The sun was wearing sunglasses, the phrase, "Que pasa, amigo?" printed beneath it.
The fuck does the sun need sunglasses for? Mia thought randomly. Come on, sis, Sunshine Devil Girl persisted. Is it because you're scared?
She bent down and brought her face within mere inches of Mia's, and Mia could smell the marijuana on her breath. Something dirtier, too. A thing that goes down deep. The crusty sore at the corner of her mouth looked like a tiny tortoiseshell.
You're scared, aren't you, sis?
Mia just shook her head. She kept her gaze leveled on the girl. After a moment, she said,
Okay, fine. What the hell? Go ahead and tell me my future. For posterity.
And she held out her hands, palms up, for Sunshine Devil Girl to examine.
Nah, sisterhood, Sunshine Devil Girl said, and she executed a clumsy roundhouse kick to Mia's hand. I'm not a fucking palm reader. That's amateur hour bullshit, sis. That ain't me. My mistake. See, you got a telescope straight into someone's soul.
She stretched her arms again above her head, her t-shirt rising high enough to expose a luminescent white panel of abdomen. Her belly button was pierced and looked like a doll's nose, her ribs like a bear trap. Then she brought her hands down in front of her face, each hand making a circle through which she peered at Mia with one eye.
Like looking through a telescope, all right? Or maybe it's like a drill, you know? One of those big spooky drills they used to get oil out of the ground. Only it's not the ground, and it's not oil. You hear me?
Sure, Mia said.
I'm talking about your body, sis.
I hear you, Mia assured her.
And your hole is so big I could see it from the street, Sunshine Devil Girl said. Like from the far end of the alley, even.
That's pretty descriptive.
I'm being serious, sisterhood. That's why I just had to come over and jaw with you, you know? Everyone's got an opening, like a hole straight through to the center of them. Some are small as a pinprick.
But mine's not, Mia said.
Yours is like a fucking tunnel in the side of a mountain, sis. And that means I gotta be extra careful. I gotta go far enough down to puncture and pass through the bubble of your destiny without bursting it. I'm like a surgeon that way. Or maybe a plumber. Gotta go straight down to the very bottom of the well. Thing is, I don't want to fall in and get stuck.
Mia smiled as the girl peered at her through the telescope of her hands. But the smile felt strained and too much like a grimace. That comment about going down to the well? It unnerved her. There was suddenly a bad taste in her mouth, too.
Where'd this fucking junkie come from, anyway? It's not like a telescope, and it's not like a drill, spoke up a voice in the back of Mia's head. It's closer to a camera lens, which is fitting, but it's also something else. Something darker, something more dangerous, something that goes straight through the center, all right?
Ain't you gonna ask me what I see? Said Sunshine Devil Girl.
Mia cleared her throat and said,
What do you see?
It's bleak as fuck, sis, I'll be honest with you.
What is it, exactly?
That's just it. Bleak as fuck, you hear me? It's all over you, filling you up like shit water through a pipe.
All right, Mia said and stood up.
Thanks for the insight. At Mia's back, the fire door opened and the event coordinator poked his burly head out.
You got 5 minutes, Mia.
Thanks.
The coordinator shifted his attention to Sunshine Devil Girl, who was still studying Mia through the circles of her hands.
Telescope.
To Mia, the guy said,
This chick bugging you?
It's cool, Mia said.
I'm not doing nothing, dickhead,
Sunshine Devil Girl said to the guy, still gazing with one eye through her hands at Mia.
Leave me the fuck alone.
Give a holler if you need anything, the event coordinator said to Mia, then vanished back behind the door.
Listen, I gotta go, Mia said, reaching into the rear pocket of her jeans.
But what about your future?
You told me. Bleak as fuck, remember? Thanks for that.
She extended a few crinkled bills to the girl.
What's that for?
Not for telling me my future, Mia said. That would be bad karma.
Then what's it for, sis? For this enlightening conversation. Sunshine Devil Girl suddenly adopted the countenance of a wary forest critter, some weak and helpless thing that only knew how to eat, sleep, fuck, shit, and sense danger. Yet, in the end, she plucked the bills from Mia's hand and wedged them into the too tight pocket of her jean shorts.
Have a good night, Mia said, pulling open the exit door.
Wait!
Mia turned around. The glow from the nearby lamppost made Sunshine Devil Girl's skin shimmer with anotherworldly radiance. Sickly, yet somehow beatific, too.
Something's coming, and it's gonna cross your path, Sunshine Devil Girl told her. Whatever you've been running from, it's about to catch up to you. So keep an eye open so you don't miss it. You get me, sis?
For a moment, Mia could not move. She stood there with one hand clutching the door handle, the other driving her fingernails into the tender meat of her palm. A sudden, curious needling at the back of her brain urged her to bolt down the alley, to jump in her Jeep and get the fuck out of Van Nuys, and not look back.
Sis? You get me?
The spell broken, Mia blinked her eyes, shook her head to clear it. She nodded, suddenly feeling like she was the train wreck in this little duo. How'd that happen? One of those M. Night Shyamalan twist endings.
Sure, she told the girl. I'll keep an eye out. Thanks.
You got it,
Sunshine Devil Girl said, already receding back into the shadows of the alley. She blew Mia a kiss.
Much love, sis.
Mia Tomasina watched her go until the darkness of the alley swallowed her up. 2. She was just a junkie with a creative streak, but something about that encounter resonated with Mia. There was no logical reason to be afraid, nothing specific in what the woman had said to trigger anything. Yet she couldn't shake it, couldn't let it go. She spent the following week in L.A., taking meetings, quarreling with distribution companies, discussing imaginative ways to coax money from would-be financiers, and holding bitch sessions about the industry with her fellow filmmakers over sake bombs at Nagoya. Yet Sunshine Devil Girl's warning persisted. Whatever you've been running from, it's about to catch up to you. You get me, sis? It got to the point where she started to ascribe meaning to innocuous things. The bark of Ms. Lopez's dog in the apartment complex every night. The days when her mail came an hour later than it should. The patterns in traffic signals. One evening, after meeting with an actor friend of hers at a bar in Long Beach, she was driving home when the power went out up and down the boulevard on either side of her. The houses all went dark. The traffic lights died, a car alarm started blaring somewhere in the distance. Panicked that she might miss something momentous, she pulled her Jeep over onto the side of the road, climbed out, and stood in the middle of that desolate, powerless street, looking for what exactly. She didn't know, and too much of this was liable to drive her crazy. She was booked at a film festival in Utah, but when her flight into Salt Lake City was delayed twice, she began to wonder if this was some sort of sign. Were the gods transmitting code to her via airline delays? Still, it was good to leave Los Angeles, because maybe that meant she'd leave her newfound hypersensitivity behind too. Yet, while at the festival, she found herself assigning weight to seemingly inconsequential things, much as she had done back in L.A. The number on the door of her hotel room, 218. The time slot she was given to show her film, 11:11, which was a time almost too random to be random. It must mean something. The curious biplane that kept sweeping across the desert sky every day at noon as if to alert her to some impending catastrophe. Was there some deeper meaning embedded here? Something she'd been warned to keep an eye out for?
Whiten your teeth with Crest, said the woman on the hotel TV, and Mia thought, what?
When she returned to L.A., she had lunch at an outdoor Japanese restaurant with a friend's mom, a woman who was supposedly clairvoyant or some such thing. She was seeking confirmation.
or perhaps whatever the opposite of confirmation was, hoping that this woman might untangle the wires she had somehow unwittingly gotten herself knotted up in. She told the woman, whose name was Elsie, about the encounter with Sunshine Devil Girl behind the theater in Van Nuys, and what this girl had said to her. Elsie laughed garrulously after hearing the story, then affected a pitiable, almost condescending tone as she patted the top of Mia's hand from across the table. Elsie's fingers were bejeweled with all manner of cheap titanium rings, and the sleeve of bracelets along her wrists jangled and chimed like coins spewing from a slot machine.
Mia, dear, you are honestly saying that some strung-out junkie lurking in an alley in Van Nuys has spooked you this badly? Sweetheart, why on earth are you getting so worked up over this?
It was a good question, one Mia didn't have an answer for, one she kept asking herself.
It must have been some act, Elsie concluded. I don't think it was an act. Darling, it's always an act.
Mia wasn't so sure.
Come on, come on,
Elsie ultimately beckoned, wiggling her fingers at Mia. Elsie was already on her third gin and tonic by this point.
Throw those dainty little paws on up here.
Mia placed her hands on the table and Elsie twisted her wrists so that Mia's palms faced the sky. Gently, Elsie raked her long acrylic fingernails across Mia's palms. It tickled. Mia's own fingernails had been gnawed to nubs, the remnants of black nail polish on some. She felt suddenly embarrassed of her hands.
Now there's a story,
Elsie said, running a thumb along the crude speed bump of a scar along Mia's left wrist. Clearly self-inflicted. Mia tugged that hand away, self-conscious of the old wound.
Right hand for females for reading birth traits,
Elsie explained.
Left hand for females for reading the future.
Is the future the same as destiny? Elsie seemed somewhat perplexed by the question.
It's what your future holds, Mia, though nothing is set in stone.
The future, then, Mia said, reluctantly placing her left hand back on the table. Elsie studied Mia's palm.
Amateur hour bullshit,
Mia thought, and pictured Sunshine Devil Girl pirouetting in some gloomy back alley at the edge of the world.
Well, see, so this is good news,
Elsie said.
What? Well, look, you see, your love line is long and you've got two very distinct marriage lines.
See here? See?
Is there perhaps a certain gentleman in your life at the moment? Someone special?
Mia laughed. There hadn't been a gentleman in her life since Vince Overmeyer had coaxed her hand down the front of his pants while in the backseat of his parents' car when she was still in high school. That had been the first and last gentleman she'd ever had in her life, thank you very much. I don't think this is about romance, Mia told her. Isn't there, like, a lifeline or something? Something that will tell me if I'm about to die? Elsie gulped at her. It was almost comical.
You're not about to die, Mia. Good Lord, the stuff that's in your brain. Is that where all those weird movie ideas come from?
How do I know what I should be looking out for?
You won't know because there's nothing there, dear.
Then why do I feel so certain that you are wrong and that junkie chick in the alley was right? Elsie withdrew her hands across the table. If Mia had offended her, that hadn't been her intention. Elsie finished her drink, then stared with disquieting intensity at Mia. She had red freckles in her hazel irises.
Can I speak candidly with you, dear?
Of course, Mia said.
I don't think you need to be consorting with me or anyone else who deals in the spiritual realm,
Elsie said.
I do, however, have the name of an excellent psychotherapist.
3. Around the time I was attending my third Alcoholics Anonymous meeting, having been clean and sober for over 90 days, sipping a cup of lukewarm coffee while seated in an uncomfortable folding chair next to Emily Pearson in the basement of the First United Methodist Church on Mill Street in downtown Akron, Mia Tomasina was checking into a rather undignified motel in Lexington, Kentucky. The room was paid for by the fans of Feral Female Cinema, a horrible name for an organization, Mia thought, and was part of her stipend for attending yet another showing of Dead Rabbit, followed by yet another Q&A. It seemed she made her living more and more these days talking about her movies as opposed to making them. She had hopes, based on the success of her latest film, Bulletproof, which had been acquired by one of the notable streaming services of our time, that she might be able to raise $500,000 for a future production she'd been kicking around, because she was ready to focus all of her attention on her work. Although she'd obsessed over what the strange woman behind the theater in Van Nuys had said to her for nearly 2 months, she had ultimately climbed out of that strange hole to rejoin the land of the living. That was it. The land of the living. A proper fucking noun. It was a 2-day event, beginning on the first evening with a dinner at some restaurant that had clearly once been a Chili's. Perhaps 30 members of the Fans of Feral Female Cinema Film Group were in attendance, most of them heavy-set and odorously off-putting. There were one or two younger women among them whom Mia found attractive, but she'd learned long ago not to mix pleasure with, well, whatever the hell this was. The event was tolerable at best, but went downhill when Mia suggested the group rename themselves the Fans of Feral Female Films, to at least comport with the whole F alliteration. This proposal was met with blank stares, as if she'd just spoken in some foreign tongue. Anyway, it was nothing a few scotch and sodas couldn't handle. The following evening, the group showed a print of Dead Rabbit in a dilapidated old theater. When she went outside to smoke a J before the Q&A, she could see the lights of a carnival in the distance. She watched the great Ferris wheel crank lazily against the night sky, nearly lulling her into a trance. It reminded her of Sunshine Devil Girl's t-shirt. Before heading back into the theater, she closed one eye and traced the outline of the Ferris wheel with one finger. A circle. "My movies," she said, "are these really angry, really depraved things. That's a direct reflection of me as a filmmaker. You walk in mid-scene, you'd think you're watching a snuff film, or a Nazi propaganda film, or just someone's psychedelic nightmare imprinted on celluloid. I tried doing the commercial sellout thing, but I didn't have the spine for it. Or maybe I had too much spine for it. I don't know. The industry sucks, and the people are about as genuine as a $3 bill. Anyway, I've never played well with people. Fuck 'em, I say. I'll make my own way." The women stood and applauded. As part of their appreciation, they gave her a gift basket of cheap screw-top wine, a keychain, and a Fans of Feral Female Cinema t-shirt. "Official member," it said over the left breast. Their questions had been pedantic and grating. Or maybe Mia just hadn't been in the mood. Whatever the case, she was relieved when it was all over and she was able to climb back into her rental car and head back to the motel. She'd be on a flight to LA first thing in the morning. Yet despite her exhaustion, she found herself detouring off the highway and heading in the direction of the carnival, where she spent the next half hour strolling along the midway while picking apart a bright pink ball of cotton candy. And that was when it happened. A man stood among the crowd, staring at the carousel as it went round and round. Calliope music shrilled while little kids waved to their parents as the intricately carved horses went up and down, the way he stared at those kids on the carousel, hungrily. A tornado came blasting through her cerebral cortex. Shrapnel went flying. She managed to fumble her phone out of her back pocket and snap a few hasty photos before the man vanished into the crowd. She hurried across the midway in pursuit, shoving people aside, scanning the crowd for any indication of where the man had gone. But she could not find him. "Something's coming, and it's going to cross your path. Whatever you've been running from, it's about to catch up to you. So keep an eye open so you don't miss it. You get me, sis?" She got her all right. Jesus Christ, she got her now. 4. Around the time I received the phone call from Detective Aiello informing me of my mother's passing and my brother's peculiar half-naked romp along the shoulder of a highway, Mia Tomasina went online to locate a lost but not forgotten childhood friend. This man's name was Clay Willis. She hadn't spoken to Clay in many, many years and wasn't sure he would be happy to hear from her now. She could locate no phone number for him, but she did manage to find an email address. From deadrabbitmia@tomasinafilm.com to cassiusclaywillis@chromemail.com. Subject: Hello from Planet Childhood. "Clay, I wish I could be there right now as you read this to see the look on your face. Am I a ghost? Am I a figment of your imagination?
What I am is a dispatch from your childhood. Remember me? I've attached a photo to this email. It was taken the other day in Lexington, Kentucky. No context. I just want you to look at it. If it means something to you, hit me back. I know how this sounds. I really do. All my love, Mia Tomasina. The arrowhead cursor hovered over the send button for an eternity. Was this madness? Was this stepping over a line? Was this her destiny? In the end, she hit send. So be it.
Chapter 3. A Reluctant Homecoming. 1. For nearly 2 decades, I had been coasting along on a trajectory that, by design, kept me a safe distance from Blackmouth. There were several reasons for this, although I rarely reflected on what any of them might be. That I was running from something occurred to me only on those fleeting occasions when I'd scream myself awake from a nightmare as vivid and substantial as a pair of hands tightening around my throat. Yet here I was. The Mav's radial tires gobbling up miles of blacktop, windows down, motoring alongside a wind tunnel that was maybe a jet engine, maybe a cyclone. An anonymous interstate that wound through productive little towns, a bumper crop of swimming pools and double-wide trailers, roadside chicken joints and boxcar motels, and roadkill with their bellies unzipped that lay marinating in a goulash of silvery entrails. My skin reeked. My body felt clammy. I imagined each of my exhalations as a toxic gray fog sputtering from my parched, quivering lips. It was much, much later in the day than I had intended it to be when I'd made my promise to Detective Aiello to come out here. It was almost evening. At one point during my drive, I pulled into the parking lot of a strip mall and had a drink at a Mexican restaurant. Had two, just to take the edge off. At another point, I pulled over onto the shoulder of the road, scrambled out of the car, and puked up my guts into the tall white fronds of grass. A van had pulled up about 50 yards ahead of me, and there was a boy no more than 7 years old taking a whiz in the underbrush. He stared at me as I wiped vomit from my mouth with my shirt sleeve, then staggered back to my car. I had spent the previous night a hostage in my apartment, staring at the bottle of Kettle One I had purchased immediately after my phone call with Detective Aiello. It stood on the kitchen counter, its brown paper bag like a pair of pants it had dropped to its ankles, enticing me. My cell phone, resting atop a stack of paperback novels next to the couch, rang a handful of times during this standoff. It was the same caller each time. I knew this without having to look at the caller ID. Emily Pearson. A fellow 12-stepper. First meeting, we had exchanged phone numbers. To give a call if one of us failed to show up. A lifeline. But it wasn't Emily Pearson I was thinking about in that moment. I was thinking about Blackmouth. I was perspiring about it. Trembling about it. The prospect of returning to that place brought with it a flood of emotion that nearly crippled me. I was trying to fool myself into believing that I could pick up Dennis from that police station in Sutton's Key and never have to set foot in the mouth. It was possible, wasn't it? I could hire someone to sell the house remotely, couldn't I? Or pay an arsonist to burn the fucker to the ground? Similarly, I could handle my mother's burial arrangements from afar. There was no need for me to do any of that in person, was there? I'd been deflecting my entire adult life. Blackmouth could call me home, but I didn't have to obey. I was also thinking about Dennis. He'd spent his entire life in that suffocating little farmhouse. Now that our mother was dead, where would he go? Were there government-funded programs for people like him? What about his doctors? People with my brother's condition generally had a host of medical concerns and were often dead of a heart attack before they were 40. That wasn't something I was prepared to deal with. Of course, there were other things waiting for me back home. Dark things. Things with cold hands and long memories. Things I'd kept packed away in the blackest recess of my mind all these years that now seemed to be reaching out for me all over again. I'm as big as you are, said the bottle of vodka. Bigger, even. I'd like to say I concluded that evening by cranking the cap off that bottle of vodka and pouring it straight down the kitchen sink. But that's not what happened. I recalled a guy from the foundry who'd once claimed that he'd been able to quit smoking by carrying a pack of cigarettes around with him every minute of the day. Whenever he'd get the urge to smoke, he was comforted by the fact that he knew he could. That at any moment, if the cravings got too bad, he could just peel the cellophane right off that pack of smokes and go to town. And for some reason, that ease of access,
That knowledge that he could do it whenever he wanted because his cigarettes were right there with him kept the craziness from infiltrating his brain. It kept the monsters at bay. It allowed him to delay smoking one of those cancer sticks indefinitely. He just kept saying to himself, "One more minute. One more minute. I'll go one more minute, then I'll have a smoke." And somehow that was enough to get him across the finish line. My plan was to stow the bottle of Kettle One in the trunk of the Maverick, right there with me, keeping the craziness from infiltrating my brain, keeping the monsters at bay. Together, we would speed toward oblivion, toward the mouth. That wasn't what happened. I drank, and then I popped an Ativan and washed it down with some more booze. And a thing, manlike, detached itself from the darkness. 2. In the summer of my 11th year, a monster came to Blackmouth. It came in the night, slinking below the sight line of normal folks, destined to arrive at the threshold of my youth. Perhaps it sought me out the way a bloodhound tracks a scent. Or perhaps it was sheer happenstance, a flip of a coin, a flutter of distant butterfly wings. Events in our lives often have meaning because we choose to give them meaning. Whatever the case, it arrived in the way monsters sometimes do, as a creature in need. A clash of thunder, a deluge of rain, some indistinct sense of wrongness roused me from a fitful sleep. I rolled over in a bed damp with sweat just as a flash of lightning pulsed against the bedroom window. Briefly, Dennis's silhouette stood in sharp relief against the dazzle of a storm-churned sky. It was the hottest summer in 100 years, or so the old-timers in the key attested, and Dennis and I had taken to sleeping with our bedroom window open because the old farmhouse's HVAC unit was on the fritz. Again. "Dennis," I said, sitting up in bed. My sheets were soggy with dream sweat, and the breeze coming through the open window on the storm felt good against my hot, sticky flesh. "What are you doing over there? Get back in bed." Dennis didn't answer. Didn't get back in bed. That was Dennis's way. He only pressed his face against the screen. Rainwater rushed in, sprinkling against his face and chest, raindrops tapping along the windowsill. I climbed out of bed and joined my 9-year-old brother at the window. The floorboards were wet beneath my feet. "It's just a thunderstorm," I told him, a half whisper. Maybe the storm had frightened him. Maybe something else had. "Go back to bed." Dennis was staring out into the yard across the dark field of desiccated alfalfa toward the edge of our property. It was where the black crest of trees rose up like something massive and prehistoric and deceivingly alive. I saw it, a flicker of tangerine light dancing between the warped slats of the barn at the edge of our property. Firelight. Someone was in there. "Maybe it's Dad," I said, though I didn't believe it. He and Mom had gotten into it earlier that night. She'd taken a Valium and a glass of wine and gone to bed while he'd sped off in his ink-black Pontiac Firebird and hadn't yet come back. The bird wasn't in its usual spot, which was the sandy patch of driveway that separated the farmhouse from the field in a wide loop. Sometimes he stayed away for days at a time, depending on how drunk or ornery he got after a fight with Mom. "Stay here," I told Dennis, then went to my dresser. I pulled on a pair of cargo shorts and a t-shirt. Dennis didn't even turn to watch me sneak out of the room. He just kept his round face pressed against the screen, as if he might at any moment disperse into a million tiny pieces and pass right through it and out into the night. I went down the hall and eased my parents' bedroom door open a crack. "Rick?" I heard my mother's drug-addled snores, glimpsed her pale white form sprawled out across the bed in the darkness. The room stank of those terrible hand-rolled cigarettes my parents often smoked behind each other's backs. I pulled the door closed and continued down the hall, down the stairs, down into the foyer of the tiny farmhouse where the back door led out onto a screened-in porch. My sneakers were there by the door next to Dennis's sandals. Dennis only ever wore sandals, no matter what, and I climbed into them, quiet as a monk, turned the deadbolt, thunk, then crept out onto the porch. The rain had cooled the air, but it increased the humidity. Each inhalation felt like I was sucking oxygen through a damp rag. I pushed open the screen door and peered around the side of the house, wondering if the Firebird might be parked out there in a different spot, but it wasn't. My father wasn't home. At the far end of the field, that eerie firelight continued to flicker and dance between the slats of the old barn. My dad used that barn to work on neighbors' cars and trucks. It was his place of business, as he called it, and he didn't like anyone else going out there without him. But he hadn't had any work in weeks. Lately, I knew he had only been going out there to drink, listen to the radio, and smoke those awful-smelling cigarettes. I stole a breath, stepped down off the porch, and crossed the field. The barn was a massive wooden structure, 2 stories high, fronted by a pair of corrugated metal doors on 2 rolling tracks. The doors were usually kept closed at night to prevent animals from getting in, but tonight there was a sliver of space separating them, big enough for a person to slip through. I entered the barn. Forms took shape, my father's automotive equipment, hydraulic jacks, chests of tools, pneumatic hoses, clutter. Beyond were large boxes of automotive supplies, items he had ordered in bulk from warehouses clear across the country. Romantic, faraway places with romantic, faraway names. Rose City, Elkhorn, Woodvine, Detroit. There were bales of hay back here, too, because we harvested it throughout the summer, then baled it prior to fall when my father would sell it to other farms or to commercial businesses, who usually used them for Halloween displays. We shared the tractor and baler with Ike Rosemont, another Black Mouth holdout, but my father hadn't used it this year, and the hay inside the barn was old and smelly and from last season. Those bales were stacked toward the center of the barn, a staircase of hay blocks, and it was just beyond those bales that the fire burned. I crept closer, slinking between my father's boxes of automotive supplies and spools of pneumatic hose, and when I arrived at the wall of hay, my heart was thudding in my throat. A man stood hunched over a small fire that burned within a wreath of dark rocks on the barn's dirt floor. He was completely naked, his body glistening with rainwater, his flesh devil red in the firelight. There were clothes spread out on one of the bales of hay, sodden and wet, though close enough to the fire to catch some heat and dry out. The man looked up at me, and I jumped back. "Hey there," he said. His voice was smooth as silk, and he didn't sound startled by my presence in the least. He held up his hands to show that he was harmless. "Didn't mean to scare you." "Who are you?" "I'm nobody," said the man, and I could see that he wore something over his right eye. An eye patch. "I'm no trouble at all. I'm just a guy passing through."
"What are you doing in our barn?"
"Got caught in the storm. Thought I'd come in and dry off, maybe spend the night, wait for the storm to pass." I shook my head.
"You can't do that. If my dad finds you..."
I let the silence that followed speak for itself. "Is your dad home?"
"No," I said, then immediately regretted it. "I mean, he'll be home any minute. He'll see your fire."
"All the way out here?"
"Yeah, I saw it from the house."
"Well," he said, crouching even lower on his haunches. He winced noticeably, as if in pain. "That's no good. I certainly don't want any trouble from your dad." He stood then, his body shiny and the color of magma. I shied away from his nakedness, but then looked closer. There was a good-sized scar along his flank, the scar tissue serpentine and angry-looking.
"What happened to your side?"
The man glanced down at his old injury as if he'd forgotten it was there. "This?" he said. "This is a dark bit of business. Maybe I'll tell you about it some other time."
"Does it hurt?"
"Back when it happened, not so much anymore."
"What about your,
I let the question die in the air, deciding it was too impolite to continue. The corners of his mouth elongated into a wide grin. Or maybe it was a grimace. It was hard to tell in the firelight, which was playing with his features, casting him in heavy shadow. I couldn't guess his age. Couldn't make out anything distinguishable about his face from where I stood, other than that grin and that eye patch. His hair was long and dark, slicked back on his head and dripping with rainwater, except for spidery tendrils hanging down in front of his face. "You want to know about my eye?" he said, completing the question for me. His accent wasn't from here. It sounded different, somehow. Cleaner. He articulated each of his words like someone accustomed to speaking on a stage in front of an audience. I couldn't bring myself to respond verbally, so I just bounced my head up and down. "It was just a silly accident, really. I suppose I've lived through worse in my time." He was suddenly closer to me, within a few feet of the half wall of hay bales that separated us. "What's your name, my friend?"
"Jamie Warren,"
I said, then instantly regretted it, just like I'd regretted telling him my father wasn't at home a moment ago.
Are you a deal maker, Mr. Warren?
I don't know.
Well, let's see. How about we cut a deal? You and me.
He proffered one shiny red hand in the air as if weighing an invisible currency.
If you'll bring me some food and something to drink, I'll put out this fire and disappear.
He made a circular motion with his hand as he underscored the word disappear.
This way, neither of us gets into any trouble with your old man.
Some food and something to drink, I said.
That's it, he said.
I realized he was holding out that gleaming, fire-lit hand for me to seal the deal.
That is all I need.
Do we have an arrangement?
I considered this for maybe a full minute. He didn't rush me, didn't even move, just stood there with his hand extended, his singular eye shining in the glow of the fire.
Okay, I said and gripped his hand. It was warm and moist, and I imagined I could feel the heat from the fire radiating inside his flesh.
All right, then. He released my hand. That wide grin was stretching across his face once more.
I watched as he retreated back to the fire.
Thank you, Mr. Warren.
Then I was running back through the field, back through the house, into the kitchen. I filled a shopping bag with leftovers from the fridge, then tossed in a can of my dad's Budweiser for good measure. I considered swiping some of my dad's work clothes that were hanging in the laundry room, but decided it was safe just to steal a dry towel from the shelf. I stuffed the towel in the bag with the food, then bolted back out across the field to the barn.
Here,
I said and reached over the half wall of baled hay to set the bag of food on the floor.
You are a wonder, the man said.
He crawled over to the bag on his hands and feet, peered inside, reached in, dug out one of the Tupperware containers. He held it up so he could study it before the glow of the fire. Then he pried the lid off, drew out a piece of fried chicken and tore into it like a man who'd just been rescued from a prisoner of war camp.
It's all we had, I said by way of apology.
Fit for a king, the man said.
When he chewed, he fished around in the bag until he came out with the can of Bud. He popped the tab and took a few glugs. I watched as his Adam's apple ratcheted up and down along the contour of his throat. When he was done, he sucked air in between his teeth, then unleashed a belch that sounded like a creaking door.
Want some?
He said, and extended the beer can in my direction. I shook my head. I knew what that poison did to my dad and wanted no part of it. The man nodded, took another sip, then set the can down on the ground. He screwed it into the dirt so that it wouldn't tip over. Then he dug the towel out of the bag and stared at it.
In case you wanted to dry off, I told him.
You're a thoughtful boy.
He patted himself dry with the towel.
Maybe if you just put the fire out, you can stay in here until the storm is over.
He paused in mid-dry, the towel pressed over his groin. The intensity of his one-eyed stare was like physical contact.
That is very kind of you, he said, and I could tell that he meant it. You've been very good to me, Mr. Warren. I'd like to repay you.
You don't have to do that, I told him. He didn't look
like. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.